So it's a new day. Let's get back to our show. So yesterday we did that thingy, seahorsey, and its dependencies, and that basically provides us with the prerequisites of Dayadub. Dayadub is a backup utility, I think, and which is basically integrated into GNOME, and it allows you to backup. Okay, that makes sense. So, but also, just a side note, let's just comment this out by now, because this is the don't audit for stuff that you shouldn't be able to access to. But anyways, so we need to basically make the Dayadub work, because yeah, it's basically integrated into a Nautilus where you can basically reset files to older versions and stuff like that. And so that is one of the high priority apps, because it's basically integrated into the main Nautilus application. So yeah, that's basically what we're going to focus on today. It's not basically one of my favorites, but we gotta face them all. So yeah, I guess we should just do that. So, but before we can actually go ahead and do that, we need to basically create ourselves some credentials. And that's basically makes it even harder, because you know the routine. We need to basically test that stuff. So every time we need to create credentials, and yeah, sucks. But let's just do that first. So we are enforcing. Let's just create ourselves some keys. Let's just start with the secure shell key. My login. User. I need login, but login. Yeah, it's early. Add third, and just the defaults will be fine. And as you may remember that we don't actually support this create and setup functionality. We should support it at some point, but currently we just don't support that. And then the passphrase. So that's set up. Let's create ourselves a key. GPG key. PGP. GPG. For me, it's GPG. I prefer to call it GPG. Login. User. My login. User. At vert. Command. Test. Now you can use the default options here. Just create it. ABC123. An unsafe key, but this is just for testing purposes. Of course we're going to remove. We're not going to actually use these credentials. That should probably be obvious. So now I'm basically generating some entropy. At least I'm trying to. And there we have it. Let's see if we have some ABC denials. Ideally we shouldn't have anything, but yeah, there's always something. 8, 5, 50. Nothing. Good. That's the way it's supposed to be. So yeah, we now have our key set up. Let's have a look. LSLZ home. My login user. So the SSH dir is created with a proper type, and the TPG dir is also created with a proper type, and everything else was also created with a proper type. Let's have a look inside the GPG key. Oh, I'll just do this. GNU PG. So here's the setup. Now, ideally, we should probably at some point. That's probably something we should do. Create a different type for the config, actually. So make a distinction between your key files and the config file. But yeah, I guess currently we don't want to break Fedora too much, at least as little as possible. So yeah, I guess it's probably not a good idea. And now we have also the SSH. Yeah, so basically what we, yeah, we just basically have our stuff set up properly. Now, for example, your file browser cannot open it, and actually your from a shell, from an actual shell, you can't open it either. At least you can open SSH credentials, because I allowed that, but I might at some point actually deny that by default. See, you can actually access your SSH stuff, but you can't access your GNUPG stuff directly, and that's probably a good idea, because you know, it's just like Ed Snowden said in a previous interview, in a recent interview, that encryption is pretty secure. It's something that you can trust, but one of the weak points of using encryption is endpoint security, and that's basically the human aspect of encryption. Basically, the management of the key, and keeping your key, using your safe password, keeping your password safe, and stuff like that. So one of the things to improve endpoint security is basically to just deny user access to the keys. That way, in some ways, that would be more secure. But on the other hand, that's not quite true, because with regard to GPT, you can basically enhance the security of your GPT keys by actually removing the master key from your key file. And by removing the master key from your key file, it makes it harder for your adversary to actually decrypt the private key, the keys. So you'll actually, if you're really concerned about your security of your encryption, then you basically might want to remove the private, the master key from your keys, and then actually shred the files that have the master key, and then just, or at least back him up. Of course, you want to actually back up your key with the master key on some secure USB device or stuff like that, and then just put that USB device in a safe, and then shred the key file with the master key on your local machine, so that if your machine gets compromised and someone basically is able to copy your key over, your private key and your public key and your stuff like that, that he won't actually be able to decrypt it, because he doesn't have the master key. But anyways, that's something that we should consider. But I actually already have some nice ideas on how to basically deal with access to all the files to a user. I might actually at some point just create a new unprivileged role that basically just gives the user access to all its files, so that he just basically by default when he logs in that he only has access to generic content, and that he then, for example, can use sudo to open shell as itself, so not as root but just as its own user in a different role, and that that role actually has access to basically enter all the directories in the user home directory, and thus enable him to to either declassify some files and then or to just use it manage those files in some way. Those are just all concepts. Basically there's just so much work to be done that I might not even ever get to that point. But those are all possibilities, because I really like this idea where basically the user can't access the files that he shouldn't be, basically where it makes sense that he shouldn't access them. I kind of like that concept because it makes it for the user much more simpler. Basically this is saying, okay, we think you shouldn't have access to this, so the user doesn't have to be worried about it either. He just sees, okay, I shouldn't have access to this, so I guess I shouldn't be able to access it, so I shouldn't have to worry about the contents of these files. And that's basically also true thing in theory. You shouldn't have to worry about what's in there. These files are used by applications and not so much by the user itself. The only thing a user needs to worry about is his desktop directory and his documents directory and his download directory and his music pictures and that stuff, the generic stuff, but nothing else. At least not much else. And that's basically from a view of a graphical user interface user. Let's just say a Windows level user. I mean, if you put a Windows user on a Linux system, then all he knows is point and click. And that's basically the idea. So we're basically, this desktop is basically for a Windows class user, one that only knows how to point and click anyway. It wouldn't make sense to give him more power because he doesn't know how to use it anyway. All he knows is point and click. So why should I give him direct access to config files? He's not familiar with a shell. He's not familiar with editing config files and editing files and stuff like that. All he knows is how to run Microsoft Word and Microsoft Outlook. And in this case, all the users should know is how to basically run these programs in the menu and let these programs do the stuff for him. So that's basically the idea I envision. And of course you can basically make it more flexible and then just add additional roles or something like that, so that if really needed he could basically make himself a power user or something like that. Anyway, so we have set up our keys. Now we basically need to take care of our stuff. So I'm just closing this browser of this shell, the thing. And now I'm going to basically go to the menu. We're in forcing mode. I'm going to just try and open this backup utility, which should fail. Well, it doesn't. Yeah, it should fail, but it doesn't actually fail in an obvious way, probably, because we do already allow shell access to actually execute it, but not run it. So it should. It does fail pretty good. So yeah, they are the preferences, that's it. So now we're going to use the apcd now to actually see where that file is. That's actually, this is stuff that we should silently deny. But this is actually it, so let's use the raw apcd now, or the, Deya, grab Deya. But we already know enough. Shell is running the preferences. We already have this stuff labeled here. So yeah, we can basically start and get going. First we just need to set up an initial transition. This is data dip mon. We don't need that. We already did that. Data dip references. So this basically is, and this data dip is probably in the daemon. So basically what we need to do is we can borrow some stuff from our sysmon, because data dip is actually run by shell manually when you basically click. When you basically click the the icon, then stuff happens, and that is the first transition we need to worry about. So this is not one of the favorite apps. Actually, I don't use this app at all, but yeah, since it's tightly integrated into GNOME, we should just take care of that first. It's a high priority. All these things that are added by default are high priority apps, in the sense that, well, they integrate into GNOME. So we would like to deal with them in a gracious way, or in a graceful way, how do you call that? And once we've done that, then we can actually choose our own things. Although we still have to also take care of dependencies when we do that. But we should provide at least the basics. So basically we're still working on the semi-base. It's not quite base anymore, but this is semi-base. So yeah, make F. This is module. And at this point we should also go back to permissive mode and to basically expose the don't audits. There's a lot of activity going on Q&A or QA. Sure, but today I need to prepare RPMs for my policy. So it was faster to ask. Yeah, but that's a bad way to learn. Okay, so yeah, we did that. So let's just SEModule DB. And then set a 4.0 and then just run that app, I guess. I guess that's what it's all about. And I'll just close this one. For now we're done with it. So So yeah, let's run this backup thing. Here we have it. This is the start. Just opening it. So we have 9:20 already. Time flies when you're having fun. So I'm making it 9:15 there, right there. And then other two are low, and then 5:30 less. And let's see if it runs anything in the background. First take care of any transitions. But currently it seems not to be running anything yet. Is it? Do we see an execute here? No, we don't see an execute here. So for now we're safe to add these rules. The transition happened, by the way, of course, you can see that. That those are things that I basically expect you to be able to identify. But as you can see, there's a process running with the data press underscore T domain type. So that means that the transition actually did happen, else these would be run by shell, which it obviously doesn't. All right, back to our file. The press. Whatever. He's in here then. And you know the deal, what's right now is basically the same old stuff all over again. We have some obvious stuff, fonts, interaction. We have ourselves X-server interaction. We have ourselves deconf and actually deconf config and temp. So yeah, you can basically borrow a lot of stuff probably from here, and it's basically all this stuff, this. Let's just put all this there and just put it in here and then just work through it. At least password file now that's already there, so that I'm not going to type it over. And then just basically change. So this is basically the basic templating stuff that applies to any graphical user application in a GNOME environment. They're all doing the same thing. So at some point you could actually just make some templates. But I already suggested that before, but that's just something that is that's basically I would basically classify that optimization, and optimization happens later. First we need to basically have a good overview of what it actually means. And once we have that all sorted out properly, we can basically do optimization and then just make things much more compact, at least from a user perspective. Push comes to shove, the rules are raw anyways, because that's the only thing that as a Linux understands, raw policy. Alrighty, so we have this one. So that's pretty much. So this is something I think it probably wants full access to temp here. So I'll just do the following. This is basically slash temp, that's pretty obvious. So we basically do get attribute, search, and also open and read. So this basically full access to actually list them. Now this makes sense I think, because yeah, this thing probably wants to basically wants to use them to for its backup purposes. And not sure how, but we'll see. So yeah, this is basically giving us some base. Well, it probably already is a deepest chatting because it was already connecting to the session bus, so that means that it might actually already be in chatting to other components of the desktop. So yeah, let's just see. Less for Lord Muscle Toss. And yeah, it's already acquiring service on the session bus. And here we already have it chatting to Atsp and DVFS. So it's already chatting. So we basically can take care of that. So I'll just say till, well, couple hundred, 200 maybe, to make sure that we have them all. And of course I need to put in the N, because there is no 200 file. So this is what we have here, and then just copy that and add those in as well. The dop pref, and then just all the way below will take care of the debus. And so yeah, here it's basically chatting to atsp2, which is a bi-directional chat. It asks a question and gets an answer. But this one here is basically a-directional, I guess that's what it's called, I'm not sure. But because this is the user session bus, it's just getting it's just asking for service. And this is bi-directional GVFS. Actually, it might actually also be not be bi-directional, but I'm just treating this as bi-directional. Because, well, this GVFS thing is a hub. Basically, all it is, it's a broker. I guess that's a good thing to call it. Basically, this is like the broker of all the GVFS components. That's at least that's how I view it. I might be wrong from a technical view, but from an SE Linux view, this basically if some program needs to isn't dependent on some GVFS component, like for example GVFS network, then it needs to go to through GVFS, and GVFS basically is a broker between the application and the GVFS component, the actual GVFS component. That's the way I view it from a Linux perspective, but from a technical and perspective, GVSD might actually be a whole different thing, but that's my my take on it from my perspective. So let's just save it, and let's just click it before it the screensaver kicks in. Oh, my coffee is now done, unfortunately. Unfortunately, this is also taken care of. We're done? Yep, we're done. So basically what we need to do is set up some prefs. Show me my backup. Okay, so help. So this probably means that it's going to be needing to run the Yelp. Let's just try that out. For small steps, incremental steps. The prefs. And then just add the runs Yelp. And that'll take care of Yelp. And then let's see if that works. Small steps. Well, actually, it seems small steps, because we basically created a template, a quote template, unquote, for Yelp. So, but actually, by just assigning that attribute, we're actually doing a lot of stuff. So now let's hope that it actually runs Yelp and not some web browser or stuff. No, it runs Yelp. So that's cool. So that should not give us too many ABC denials, at least not the applicable ones. That's reading proc, and it's actually doing some stuff with system dbus, so we basically need to look at that from a different perspective. But that's basically all, so we can basically use 25, and it gives us a little bit cleaner. Alright, so actually it's already running something. Let's see what it's running. Python. It's running Python. That means that we can ignore that for now. We should actually... Isn't Python just a shell? I guess not. I guess it's an interpreter or something like that. But anyways, that means, since it just runs Python and we can't actually confine Python, that would be a bad idea. We need to actually just ignore this execution for now. So, yeah, damn. So it's actually going to have to be able eventually to run generic bins, but we're going to comment it out for now, but we're going to add the remainder and work through that. So it's the top prefs. Let's put that somewhere here. And we comment this out for now, but we will need it. We have ebus, but we can basically use that. I get that somewhere else, and the same goes for the user home ticket attributes. What's that? We need to take a look at that. So ebus, let's just look for ebus. Ebus config home. Get this. Just get this. And then go back to our dup prefs. And then just modify this ebus stuff, because it's not quite. That's actually, oh no, yeah, it's actually, it actually, this is fine. But eventually it actually also needs to probably read a file in there, if you actually use ibus. But I don't actually use it, so that's why it suffices, that's why it's now already happy with just listing that there. It just finds out, okay, there's nothing there, so there's nothing for me to read there. So now we have this one here, and for now I'm just going to keep that simple as well, because I don't know what it's actually doing here. But I'll just make this var like the, let allow it to search it and get attributes of it. Later on we'll may be able to find out why it's actually doing this. Maybe it wants to eventually connect to the system bus. We'll see later. We can't make any assumptions here. It's actually opening the URandom. And this is config, so this basically we can basically put this up where the deconfig stuff is, so that we can have at least some. So yeah, that user home t, what's going on there? So let's just go save and exit this, and just grab user home t and see what it's actually trying to get attributes of, whether something is mislabeled or now. It's obvious that it eventually, well, I'm not sure if this one actually needs access to user home content, well, at least to some extent obviously, because yeah, it wants to, but the backup solution eventually needs just full access to generic content. That's obvious. It needs to basically backup generic content and restore generic content. So, but this is just the preferences dialog, so that's probably not the underlying backup facility. So let's just so here you have storage on Amazon. So you can basically set the storage. Now, I'm going to use, let's see, I've actually a couple of things that I need to test. Yeah, actually, eventually, so by default, it basically just wants to back up the whole directory without trashing downloads. And that's probably also why it's actually trying to get attributes of downloads. So we really just need to think about our goal here. You see, there's so many options. I don't have an Amazon or a Rackspace cloud, so I can't test that. I don't have a Windows share, I don't have web dev, I do have FTP by the way, but that's a public FTP server, so that doesn't allow people to write to it. That's a anonymous FTP, so I can't actually use that, and I'm not going to configure FTP to allow writes. So that functionality basically I'm going to ignore, because I can't deal with all the functionality anyways. So I'm just going to try and focus, at least first I'm going to focus on local folder, and then I'm going to probably also focus on SSH, I guess. So what I'm going to do now is basically sucks. It quite sucks indeed. Let's just have a smoke and think about this. If it weren't a high priority app, I would have ignored this thing. But it's a high priority app. You know what? I'm actually going to focus on SSH. I'm just basically going to back up to my other users thing. Let's just have a look first at see if we have some other stuff in the meanwhile. Doesn't look like it. I haven't actually made and installed. So yeah, I'm going to actually set up a SSH backup. So that's what I'm going to do is actually get home my login user SSH and then what is it? Yeah, pip I guess. And then just put that into my other account. On the local system, by the way, it's just going to be a nano, and that's actually authorized keys. I'll just put this in here with a comment. Test. So now the user should be actually, or at least from that perspective, someone should be able to log in. So let's just try and set that up. So backup location is going to be SSH, server is going to be SSH, net, KB info, port is going to be, what's the default port? And then folder is home Dominic. I should make a backups folder there, but I'll just use this. And then the username is Dominic. What's our port? NetSteps, ANTLP. SSH 22. So this seems to be okay. So let's by now it should, it might probably have actually created a file or anything. No, it hasn't actually done that yet. Is there some Dbus chatting going on in the meanwhile? Yeah, there is deconf. So let's just add that in as well. The prefs and add the deconf chat in there. So I can basically copy this over. And then use deconf. 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 So we have this set up. We have this folder, basically we're backing up the whole user home directory. And then we have a schedule. I'll leave this by default. Want to support as much of the defaults as possible. Automatic backups, we're turning this off for now. And then just once it's done, just try and make a backup. But it's probably going to run something. This is encryption. So this is GPG. Remember passwords. There's a lot of stuff going on here. There's a hell of a lot of stuff going on here, and we're going to have to do this a couple times. So this really sucks. See, here we have DBus running something. Now look at this stuff here, GPG. So this really, we need to take care of damn, look at this. Look at this. So we're really opening up a can of worms here. We need to take care of transitions. Now there are some things that I can just. So this basically needs to, we need to take care of this DBSD. So grab DBSD and then grab Binti or bin and grab execute. Hot plug sniffer. So that's one thing we need to take care of. So yeah, this is really an app that has its thanks in a lot of stuff. Hot plug sniff. So you know, first things first, take care of your transitions as much as you can. So hot plug sniff. This is a daemon session service, session bus service. So we're gonna go all the way below and set that up. And we really need to be careful. We need to make sure that we actually apply the file context. We need to really do this step by step. A GFS burn is a DBus. No. Oh no, this GFS, this is one. Hot plug sniff. But we need to do as much as we can, so we really need to use our skills to make as much work in a single run as possible, because it just takes a lot of time to set this up. You basically need to create a key and do all kinds of stuff to just actually be able to test this stuff. So that's just one of the shitty things about this. But yeah, if you use your skill and you make some assumptions, then you can get far without having to rerun the tests thousands of times. This is at least something. So this is one transition. But before we go any further, we're going to build, install, and restore con.pass before we forget. Restore con v. Okay, that's done. Let's go ahead and look at other stuff carefully. So what does it execute? And we could basically just do this. So the prefs is running a generic binary. So we need to basically have a look at that and see if it's actually the prefs running a binary. So the prefs, the prefs. See if it's actually data perhaps running that binary. So here we have, so there's a mix here. The prefs does run generic binaries and needs to probably be able to do that, but that's not the whole actual picture, because also the itself runs generic binaries. And there's probably, and we know that datadup prefs runs datadup. And here we have duplicity, whatever the heck that is, user bin duplicity, which gets run by datadup. Now, what is duplicity? Do some research. Duplicity. Linux. I don't know what it is. If it's some GNOME component, duplicity backs directories by producing encrypted tar format volumes and uploading them. So this is duplicity. It's not a GNOME component, and it's used by other things. So we're going to leave that generic. We're going to leave that generic for now. Because we don't actually expect a user to run that directly. Although it probably could. But oh man. Or should we do it? We need to think about this. Do we want to support this in a confined environment? Duplicity, I mean. Thank you. I think I'm not going to support that by default. Simply because no, I'm not. I'm just not gonna do that. Not gonna support that by default. So we're gonna ignore that. Duplicity. So what the path is the following: datadup runs dataprefs runs datadup. You can see that here. You should be able to find that here. Well, you can actually see it here because datadup runs in the prefs domain, so you know that it eventually originated at prefs. And then it runs a shitload of generic utilities, and I just consider duplicity a generic utility just for the sake of simplicity. And then at some point, duplicity runs GPT. So that's the main thing here. Let's just have a look at the big picture again. Oh, look at this stuff. And here's another one. This one we can take care of, oh, but we first need to verify it. But SFTP runs SSH exec. So grab SSH, what is it? SFTP, and then SSH, and then grab execute. But this probably is right. Yeah, so this is something that we can just add, and I'll just add that first things first. So that's something I'm going to focus on now before I'm going to focus on that big heap of shit. So we have SSH, and SSH is run by DVFS SFTP. So I'm going to just use this stuff here. I'm gonna edit that. So we have my login user SSH, and then we have a require. Because this SSH utility is already labeled by Fedora, so we don't need to create a new type for the executable file. SSH exactly, then this can be removed, and then not SFTPD. So they should set up that transition. This should set up that transition, as far as I can see. All right, so let's go to Dayadip Prefs and see of Dayadip Mon. Dayadip Prefs. Oops. So what's happening here is that Dayadip Mon gets run by Dayadip Prefs. So and then this is Dayadip Prefs, which runs Dayadip. So yeah, it's pretty complex path here. And then GPG gets run by Dayadip. So we need to go to GPG. And then just verify that a couple times, then we got it all straight, because we're making some assumptions here. So that should take care of the transition. Let's just grep execute. See if you have the whole story. We took care of this. This is basically that hot plug thingy. This is done. And Dayadip Prefs runs this. It first runs some generic utilities like that Duplicity, and it runs a shell, and it runs IO nice and some other generic stuff. Then it actually runs the datadub, and then datadub runs GPG, and whoever executes this temp file, I don't know who the hell that does that. So yeah, and now let's have a look at the big picture again. See, there's a lot of stuff going on here. It's writing to cache, but we're going to delete in the next run. We're going to delete some of this stuff. GPT exec, here the execute, and then it's actually something is actually read, log, write, open stuff. In the shell, yeah, this it does Kerberos. This stuff we just need to figure out. So yeah, this is it. This is it. What we need to do is log out. Log out. I'm going to first clean up some stuff. LS, all Z, home, Dominic. Less duplicity. So here you have that stuff. So let's remove that backup. That's basically the backup. Now, next, kill all you, my login user. Then, clear my login user shell. Then, ls all z home my login user. Now, I'm not going to delete my GPG credentials, if possible. Because that would make it much harder for me. That's not my login user. That would make it harder for me. Let's have a look at GPG, because it was actually writing there. But it still seems to be yeah, that known host file, that I'm going to delete that known host file. And then lslc temp. And it did actually remove whatever it created. At least I should check var temp as well. Yeah, seems to be like that. So we should have a pretty clean testing environment to go ahead and try this again. So, data preps. We're going to do this all over again. I want to show my backup settings. Well, those should be probably be empty by now. Yeah. And then just say SSH net KB info. Port 22, wasn't it? Was it? And then Dominic. And then my login username is Dominic. That should set this up. This looks fine. Go to the overview. We're having it off. Backup now. This should. Then you need to confirm passphrase for GPT. Now let's see if the transitions actually happened. Not quite. Not quite. Weird. Did I actually? Did I? Nope. God damn it. Okay, so this is, and I'm just entering a huge black hole. I didn't actually install the module, did I? Or either that, or I just made some nasty ass mistake. Damn, man. Either that or I made a nasty mistake. I just, for now, I'm just gonna assume that I just neglected to do my job. Jesus Christ. Let's hope it's that simple. Man, oh man, oh man, man. How stupid is that? How stupid is that? I did install it this time. Transitions didn't happen. Now either that's because I neglected to actually install the new policy, or I'm doing something really wrong. One of the possibilities. The nice thing is that with writing policy like this is that the stuff that you normally never use, now you get to actually play with it a little bit. Just not for the sake of the app itself, just for the sake of creating policy for it. It's the same for that stupid cloud utility that not sure what I forgot its name, but there was this cloud utility and I would never use that in my whole life, but someone asked me to create a policy for it. And so I decided to create a policy for it, and in the process I kind of learned how it works. Now we're getting somewhere. Now we're getting somewhere. Yeah. Let's look at all the executes. Yeah, looks fine. Let's just look them raw. But yeah, this looks like I expected it. This is no, it can't be ignored. This is Python. This is a generic application. We need to keep that generic. IONICE also generic. Duplicity, we decided to keep that generic. Here it's running bash, of course, obviously generic. Duplicity again. This is temp, this is some file, and temp, which basically gets run by duplicity. This is duplicity running bash, but actually just so in the data domain, yep, so that's fine. Duplicity, datadub running duplicity, which is generic. Bash, this all looks gravy. Finally, we're getting somewhere. So we took care of the transitions, which is basically the most important thing currently. So now we can basically add these rules. Now the datadub, you can see it, it's just doing a lot of stuff. But where it goes, look at that domain. It's huge. We can basically do this one first. Copy this. Been a while since I last edited the file. Datadub. refs. And here, so I already had that execute now transfer bin, so I can basically leave that in. And then basically all I need to do is this process set chat and it's stream connecting to GVFS SFTP. Probably also DBus chatting. I'll leave that DBus chat for a little later because I don't want to get confused with stuff that we did wrong. I can have a look at it. Let's file log messages. Let's see if I can make a distinction where stuff kind of hard to tell, but there are obviously anything that runs data dub. This is probably better to just wait, but yeah, all this stuff needs to be allowed. See this as well. I just need to be very careful, so I'm going to just for now ignore the DBus stuff. So we took care of the prefs. Let's take care of some other simple stuff, like for example, now call it simple, I wouldn't call it simple. SSH. So it's reading certificates. Now to be able to read certificates, you need to also traverse the certificate there. I know that. But it doesn't show everything by default. Then it's actually read, write, inherited, dev, pseudo terminal. KRB5, yeah, that's, but it's probably also in directory involved. This is actually stream connecting to keyring daemon. We need to get attributes here. Netconfig. Primary, that's that actually that file that we created in. If it opens it, then it needs to read it as well. But actually, let's just leave that for now. But there's a lot of stuff. Read, open, get attribute. Netlink route socket, it's basically reading the routing table. And then he's doing the its thing. And then it's basically, this is known hosts. It's fine. SSH port's fine, let's just require that port. Type SSH port T. It's connecting to the remote. Search, this is basically home root T. It needs to get to SSH. So yeah, it's actually pretty home root T. It's actually pretty simple. If you want to get to the period SSH, then you need to basically traverse the user home directory, and this is actually related to that primary file. So this basically it actually needs to search into that attribute. See, to get to that primary file, you need to search user temp tethers, else you can't get there. So yeah, this is basically related. So this actually doesn't look too complicated for now. but of course probably going to, this probably won't build, probably need to require a lot of stuff. So let's see if that's true or false. Yeah, what we have, permission search is not of class search. Yeah, that's stupid, forgot to edit that. Forgot to edit that. Oh, it's SSH key gen or something else. Forgot the owl up top. Here, this one here on top. This. So it kept it file, but it's a dir. That actually does work. Now basically, that whole day a dub dance. Which is a huge set of rules. Just a huge thing to back up this, or to do. There's just no other way to describe it. Oh yeah, let's just first take care of keyring daemon. Actually, getting state and stuff. Yeah. Oh, and GPG also. Can you believe that keyring daemon is actually trying to read my SSH keys? So keyring daemon is already getting, trying to get state of a lot of stuff, I think, if I remember correctly. I thought. Actually thought that. Did I add that in another way? Weird. I would have sworn. Maybe I did edit that in a different way. No, here it is. So I'll just add these rules here. So actually, it doesn't need to get state of CRs only. It also needs to get state of data. Basically, each program that uses the keyring facility, it needs to get state of, so we can basically create a type attribute for that and then just make it simple. But at this point, probably not a good idea because I have plenty other stuff on my plate, so I'll just do it so this way for now. So that takes care of state, reading state, and then it wants to do this dance. Now it also actually needs to search home, search at dir, obviously, because else it wouldn't actually be able to get to the file. So that takes care of that. Yeah, Save and exit. Let's go back. TPD, we had some TPD stuff as well. Here's TPD. Let's just add that here for now and then just work our way through it. Okay, this here. We need to be careful. A lot of this stuff can't actually. This is a leak. Let's take care of URandom. It wants to get attribute of the URandom device. That's one simple one. And it wants to set resource limits. We can actually append that to probably set sets. Let's see if there's some other stuff to process to self. No, that seems to be. Oh yeah, here's signal, and then set R limit. Keep that grouped a little bit. So that takes care of this. This seems to be a leak, but I'm going to allow it anyways. Optimization happens later, not now. And then these two, we need to figure these out. Now the metadata data home key, that's actually that's one thing that's pretty obvious. So let's just add that metadata. Let's search for metadata. Metadata. So we can basically add this here. TPD. And then just, not this one. TPD. And then just do this. TPD. It's reading metadata, I guess. Now we can actually remove this here, allow it to read metadata, and now this cache home file, we need to take care of that, because that's obviously not right. There shouldn't be any generic cache content, but that's probably that cache file that was created by Dayadub, so this is probably going to at some point be Dayadub. I'm going to Dayadub cache home key. That's something that's to do. And then it's also going to be needing to search cache. I guess I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit here. Actually. Actually, get attribute and search. I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself here. And it's a dir. Because that type isn't even declared yet. And then it's actually cache empty. So basically what I'm allowing is I'm allowing GPT to search cache home key and then search Dayadub cache home key, which is about to be created probably, and then allow it to actually read, write, and append the existing Dayadub cache home file. All right, save and exit. And then just have a look at that Datadub stuff here. And then first let's take care of the Datadub cache content. I think it's creating a dir and a file. See, it's creating a dir and it's creating a file. So we need to basically have a look at this stuff here. So we are grabbing cache home key. And then actually just grep for create. We just need to know what it's creating. Doesn't actually give us much of an insight. But it's actually probably just everything is in that cache datadub. So let's have a look at that. ls alt z. And then home, my login user, and then cache, and then there should be a datadub there in there, and it is. And then let's just have a look in the datadub there, because everything else is confined, as you can see. It's only datadub there is generic datadub, and I'll just copy this name over because. And inside there, it's creating all kinds of stuff. All right, so let's take care of this first. So cache, and then datadub. Paste that in, and then it's called datadub cache empty. Datadub cache empty. And then. Type enforcement file datadub, and then we're going to this datadub non datadub press datadub, and so this is pretty clean right now. So let's just create a type datadub cache empty. Type attribute. Data cache home to me is a file type, and then just make that a user home type. So that's taking care of Dabo. Now we need to basically have a look at grab cache home to what it actually creates. Is actually it. The top. That doesn't work. All right. So here we created the type. So now we know at least what's going to happen here. Let's first do a type. Transition. So when datadub actually creates a dir in cache home t, then type transition from cache home t to datadub cache home t, but only do so if the dir is named datadub. So that takes care of that. So now basically you need to take care of this. Now first it just needs to be able to search and write and get attribute and add name to the generic cache. And then it basically needs to do all this stuff to datadub cache home t, and then it needs to do all this stuff to datadub cache home t files. That should take care of that stuff. Let's see what else Dayadub creates. I'm not sure if it actually creates anything more, but let's just see. It's reading a lot of stuff, but that's just basically backing up, so we shouldn't actually be confused by that stuff. So all the stuff that it just reads, we can just ignore that. So that's, yeah, that it looks like a lot of stuff here, and yeah, it is a lot of stuff actually, but a lot of stuff is just not applicable. Now here it's trying to get attribute of admin home key. Are you kidding me? Kind of hard is to filter out the stuff. So yeah, it's kind of hard to filter out the stuff, and we can make it much cleaner if we just do it this way first. Takes a little longer, but we know it actually needs to read everything in the user home directory. So it's kind of like Faurola, I guess. Not like Faurola. Like Nautilus, then maybe. Not Nautilus either. Do what file managers do. Well, actually, let's just do that manually. So what actually is going on here? We need to basically get some full access to some stuff. Now first, let's just allow Dayadub to actually just traverse Dayadub user home there get attribute and search, because if you want to basically be able to back up files and use a home, then you'll basically need to be able to homebrew T actually need to be able to traverse. That's one obvious thing. And then we need to basically allow pretty much full access to the user home directory. So how do you go about that? Full access to all user home content. Now, what we did was we basically classify all our user home content types with the user home type. So we can basically just allow my login user home type, and then dir, but not just dir, files, link files, sock files, vivo files, character files, block files, although that is sock file, vivo file, and then care file, car file. Although, yeah, I doubt that a user doesn't have a car file, but look, we should make sure that. And now we're getting this shit again, where not all permissions apply to everyone. That just sucks. Open, get attribute, read, and actually this is tough. So we need to do first things first. Search. Open. Get attribute. Read. Get attribute, read. Get attribute, read. Yeah, this is going to be nasty. Get attribute, read. Get attribute, read. Get attribute, read. Full access, yeah. Full access, but not quite. This is just the backup part for now, because the restore part is going to make it all a tad more complicated. But I'm just interesting to see how Datadub actually handles restore, but we'll see that later, I guess. Let's just save and exit that, and let's have a look again, see if I got it all figured out. So read, get attribute, open, dir. Oh, actually ibis, this ibis needs more, so but I will figure that out. Get attribute. Let's take care of some of this stuff first. It's just a lot of stuff that we can just add. This is some basic stuff. It's just a lot of basic stuff. Fonts and student shell, read sysfs, read proc, But yeah, there's just a lot of stuff that just... this one I'm going to edit but comment it out. And then let's just add some stuff here that we know. For example, wants to read this stuff, it needs this and fonts. It wants to read proc. Wants to read Sisyphus. Here. And the Sisyphus is hardly... Actually, yeah. This is it, and actually... Because a lot of stuff is allowed by default just by adding a domain, so this might actually be legit. Now, with regard to Ibis, do we have Ibis here as well? Ibis. Yeah. Now it can already do a lot of stuff, but it can't set attributes, so we just need to allow the set attribute. Since Ibis is generic user of is user home content, which Datadub already has full access to, we don't want so many duplicate rules. We just need to add the single rule that he doesn't have yet access to. What else do we have? FSD. ETC runtime wants to get attribute. Password file. TempFSD, but it doesn't actually. Oh yeah, XServer. It wants to do the XServer dance. Wants to actually read a lot of stuff here though. So it wants to do the XServer dance. That we know. The but with regards to this stuff here, we need to change that, because it actually wants to do a lot more stuff. It wants to actually list. Oh yeah, and then XServer stuff, huh? Not just that, this one as well. And password. Try to get rid of it, get rid of stuff as much as possible. Password. Next server can basically add that in as well. It's a huge domain to do. Complex as hell. I'll just leave it at this, into this one. I also confirmed this. See if this build probably needs some. Yeah, we have some. Allow it. So the user home type needs to be actually. Be required there because we're at that point we probably haven't required it yet, so it's probably unknown. So let's just require that. Oh, actually not that, it's actually something else. I just forgot to close them. I'm just going to leave it at this. At least I'm not going to leave it at this, but I'm going to basically remove the stuff again, log out, remove the stuff again, and then just try it again. So let's FE. Log out, log out. Just try this over. Try this out again. Okay. So pop. Let's clear all this stuff up again. You know the deal. It's been a while. And temp. So now I added this here so that I know where I was. Okay. So yeah, let's see our search. At 11 o'clock. Should be clean now. Or around and about. Yeah. Log in and do this stuff all over again. It's a lot of work. And that's just only the surface. There's plenty other backup, but this probably is one of the main ones. So we have this setup. don't we? Seems we do. Overview. Bring it back up now. Login anyway. Unlock. Create a password. And then enter the passphrase for my GPT key, which is the same. Now go ahead and look it up again. This all seems to be looking gravy. And see, now it's getting at least a little bit easier to look at. A lot of leaks going on. Oh yeah, we have a temp file that needs to be taken care of. And it actually wants the IO control, it's the MMT. So let's just first things first. What the hell was I doing? Oh yeah, temp file. I'm gonna paste that in here. So it's actually creating a dir and a file in there. So let's type the dup temp t and then just classify that file. And then basically, first let's just create a type transition. It's creating a dir in there, and then it's the empty. And we can't actually use the name file transition, so we need to just leave that here. Now, with regard to the file, it's pretty obvious. It's just datadup tempty, and then get be done with it. But with regard to the dir, I guess. Does need to create generic, but it probably does need to read generic dirs, and of course does need to RM it, but it needs to get attribute and search, and same it also needs to get attributes and search here, which is a datadup temp dir. So it adds basically entries and remove entries from slash temp, and it might actually need to be able to read slash temp dir listed, but I can't confirm that right now, so I won't try that. But this seems okay. All right, so now it wants to actually read XDM empty, but that's fine. Or actually, let's just XDM home T without the comment. This here can be removed. this one. Allow this for data dub. I'm gonna take a break soon though. Because, well, it's getting a little bit long now. Now just add that somewhere with BIOX server a little bit in there. Oh yeah, I need to change the stuff, of course. So yeah. Let's have a look. There was more. Of course, obviously. But first have a look at GPG was trying to access this, and this is that actually that that they adopt them file. Although it doesn't show it, but it is. So GPG, and then just add that. Now that probably just means that it could be a inheriting stuff, might actually be inheriting stuff, but I could actually just leave it this and then edit that later. Probably better to do it this way. Copy this over. So this is probably a pretty complex suite of things. Random device. This can be removed. Now this here, this can be removed. Proc the reads. This is actually, this can be added. Actually, I'll just move that up. Actually needs to list bro. This can be removed. But it's and this read open home read root. Read open. I guess you can allow that home root read open. That means it actually needs to list. This can be this one can be removed. And then we have some stuff with this is a leak. Or at least it looks like a leak. And this is string connecting to the reading var. I guess we need to allow that. And this, yeah, it's getting attributes of a lot of stuff. stuff here. It looks awfully like just getting it looks awfully lot like it's just panicking in a way. See, like, why would it need to get attribute of admin home t? That just doesn't make sense. So I'm commenting that out. Get attribute of runtime, I'll comment that out for now. Lost found t, comment that out for now. Reading mount. Yeah, I think that's probably something. Type mount t. Yeah, these people probably want to back up to some to some mounted partition. But with regard to this stuff here, this stuff is actually related to listing. The lost found t, so these three should be allowed. Because this is actually related to listing the user home. Actually not pools. Or yeah, as list not just listing, oops, not just listing user home, but also listing temp. Now, with regard to temp, we should probably just it says a lot already though. But this is actually just, so let's just allow this one here. These what is it? Lost found. And quota db t, and we might actually be able to don't audit it. List home, and then don't audit? Question mark. But for now, let's just allow that. This can be. I'll remove this from now. For now. Let's see if this builds. It's a little bit messy. So now I'm going to take care of debugs, and after that I'm going to clean up and take a break, because I can work on this indefinitely, kind of. Less far log messages, and that's probably going to be can't even find that test anymore. It's been so long. Actually, where is test? Here. Basically, I'm just gonna copy the. Yeah, that's kind of impossible as well. Yeah, this undoable. This is undoable. But I just want to make sure. That I'm not adding anything that I shouldn't add. So yeah, although it might look like a stupid thing to do, maybe it isn't the smartest thing to do, and it's probably in a quicker way to do it as well. I just think it might be just not stupid to do this. Just want to make sure that I add only what's safe to add. I don't want to add something that it's a huge file though. It's gonna take a little while. Probably a much easier way to do this. But oh well. I'm doing this in my free time, I'm not billing anyone. Look at how verbose as he troubleshoot is. Yeah, that's probably not a bad idea to be verbose, but hopefully we're a little bit close now. Heck, this is not even today. This is a few days ago. Damn. Oh, now we're at 19, so now we're getting somewhere. So I'm just looking for my test message. And then from there on. Should be close now. Queue is full, queue is full. Yeah, I'm not surprised with the amount of ABC denials that this is generating. Session. Should be closed now. Ah, there we are. So yeah. Yes, save modified buffer. File to write block text. Yeah. Less. And then cut blah text. Audit to allow less, or actually just share. Whew, that's a lot of stuff right there. So first let's just take care of data. It's chatting all over the place, as you can see. Could be worse. Yeah, these are these apps that, yeah, they're just huge. And yeah, it might not actually make much sense to confine it. Although, yeah, you will want to make sure that there's some integrity, I guess. Because if you're using a compromised SSH binary or something, there might be some stuff happening that you don't want to happen. So yeah, this is it. Data. Shell metadata CPSD. So that's fine. Let's go back into that again. And then we have SFTP. And we don't have to do the data dip for this one. So, SFTP. GVFS, the SFTP. And we don't need to do the data dip. And this HTTP. Because we already did that one. Data. You can remove this one. So here, this is single traffic. That's messy. Oh no, that's right. That's right. And we have sniff. And now we have sniff. And data press. We took care of that. Didn't we? No, we actually didn't take care of data press. Of chatting. And then take care of that hot plug. This one. This should be taking care of all of this stuff. Hopelijk sniff. What a name. It doesn't actually do anything, that hopelijk sniff, seems. Just like communication hub or something. Well, probably there's probably it's just doing something that is allowed by that domains are allowed to do by default, like for example read SysFS or actually yeah, read SysFS or reading generic proc files, and then if it can't find any hot plug stuff, so then it just craps out. That's probably something like that. remove that cut blah of the blah text, then clean up my directory logout and leave everything clean, and then take a break, take a runt, and a soda and a runt. Okay, because you can't do this stuff. In a minute, you really need to take your time. This is only backing up. Then later we need to actually restore this stuff. Well, good luck with that. And that's just basically only one method of backing up. Like 10,000 ways that you can back up. Can you give me a break? Yep, you can. Okay, have a soda and a runt, and we'll be back.